We're talking about water governance. And then last but not least, Dr. Michael Schaeffer on the issue of water pollution, the micro issue. Okay. Dr. Michael Schaeffer is a former professor of political science at the London University and currently a founder and director of the Warm Heart Foundation. Dr. Jolodian,
this morning we are talking a lot about the Water Act. To talk about the Water Act, how to draft that, we have to talk about the rule of law and sustainable development for Thailand. We do hope that the Water Act will support the development and also support the conservation. That is very important. If we could not conserve our resources, then we cannot reach to the sustainable development. So this is a talk I will pass him. He presented that on the 29th October 1981. Yes, talking. Sorry that it is in Thai language, and my staff, they try to translate that into English. It's about the same as what Dr. Anand said that law is only the tools, it's an instrument. Law enforcement must be used to maintain justice, not to maintain the law itself. Because in the past, when we are talking about the law, we are talking about when we have a problem about water, and the problem came to the court. And we try to state that what is right or wrong, but not to support the agency, water agency, how they should work. That is the principle, the main principle. This act should support the water agency, not just to not only the what is right, what is law, but we should say a lot about the duty or the function of the agency. And then I try to summarize that. Yes, we should talk about the social and governance context. In Thailand, that is, of course, it's not the same as in Europe or Japan. I separate them. I divided into three main error. One is a Scotai error, and the second one is a UTR and the beginning of Ratanakosin or Bangkok. And then at present, after we have a national economic and social development plan. So, and then I try to, what is the function of the law itself to support the government agency to work together, and also at the court, and after we have the problem, how we support them and renovate or restore justice. These are three main functions of the law itself. So in Sukhothai era, it's like a father and son. The way that our king managed the country is like a father and son, like a family. And the society is not that big, small and simple society. Paternalism. And also we focus on duty, not authorities. But in UTR, expanded and complicated society, and then start to be centralized. We have a UTR, we have a Sukhothai, and then the UTR govern all the other region. And then we start to do Vien Quang Khang Na, like authorities to manage water. When you setting up the authority, we start with right, not duty at that time, not the mandate. And at this time, the society is large and very complex society. That is the reason why we have to deal decentralized for the development and conservation, but during the crisis, we need to do centralized, the single command. The development is decentralized. That is the problem that the Water Act draft in the past, what they try to do, they try to centralize the development. But during the crisis, they had an idea that it should be decentralized. With this draft, the development would be decentralized, but the crisis should be centralized. And then to support the local administration is the key. Because when we are talking about the water budgeting, most of us in the past, we had an idea that most of the water budget comes to Loyal Irrigation Department, Department of Water Resource, but it's not that true. The local administration get much more budgeting than the Loyal Irrigation Department, but it's not present. Yes. Then, when we are talking about the distribution or distributed work, we have to talk about duties. If we focus in right, then we will have more conflicts because of number of agents who will work or who will act in water. We are talking about over 1,000 agents. So we have to talk about the duties, how we link together. And then when the problem comes to courts, in the past, and there's a quotai error, is customary law, but right now it's written statement of law, and we have more and more problems because of Thai language itself. The meaning in Thai language, it's depend on all the words, it's depend on the context. You can play with that. The same as in English, not the same as German language. The German the translation or the meaning of each sentence, it's almost definite. But in Thai, it's not. So we start to have a more and more problem. When we move from customary law to written statement of laws. And then after we had a problem, then how we renovate or restore. I like to skip that. And then the rule of law and sustainable development for Thai community. The first error, yes, as I say that, is I like to focus at the National Economic and Social Development Plan since 1971. We are talking about, at that time, the population is not that high. The forestry is getting, it was good at that time. Over 50% of Thailand is covered by forest, and quality of forest is, it was nice. Arrangement of water as required, because we have, at that time we had plenty of water. And then the second error, since the 3rd to the 8th of National Economic and Social Development Plan, we try to arrange that based on the government officer, no participation at that time. Based on academic people, based on the technical people. And since the 9th, National Economic and Social Development Plan, we start to talk about equity or equality. So we have more participation. And we think about the environment more and more. Participation and decentralization. In the past, when we are talking about the law, we almost focus in right. We don't focus in court. What is right or what is wrong, what is mistake. But this, with this law from our study, we should focus in duty, and we should focus in structure of the organization, because it's related to the structure. The technical part is not the main point. The technical part, you can put that. So we start to realize that at this time, suddenly the demand of water is 35% increasing because of tourism, because of try to export more and more agriculture or farm product. So instead of a supply management, right now we have to start to do a demand management, because we cannot build a big dam anymore, the big reservoir anymore. We have to, not because of the forest only, but what we have seen in the past decade, the rainfall map keep changing because of the climate change. Even the city like Bangkok, they have to think about the water reservoir in their own city, not to rely on the other, not to rely on Ping only, on Ping Yongnan only. So you see that right now, with the complexity of the society, we have to think about the holistic. That is the reason why we started to go along or directly this way, integrated water resource management. And integrated water resource management, it's not that enough right now. The land, integrated land and water resource management, because our land use is a key, also the key point. The human settlement, the land use, it's more and more. The idea of integrated water resource management is, you see that with the holistic approach, enabling environment, and then the policy, and then the water governance. What is the unit who will act, who will work, who will function this? The water governance at the local level to the government level. So the development in the past, when we had a problem in the past, we think about the project, we think about the program, and after that we start to monitor and then try to see some index. But right now, after 60 years of development, so we have to do it the other way. Assessment. I think we do agree, all the panelists talking about evaluation. Assessment is the key point. That is the reason why our past king initiated the idea to setting up hydroinformatics. That we start at the same time as the Netherlands start hydroinformatics. Water resource policy and strategy would come from information or assessment, what we do have. And then implementation plan or adaptation is the key point. And then work, not the project base anymore. It should be an area base. When you start to evaluate an assessment, you will look at the area base, not the project base anymore. You see, from the constitution, so we are talking about the right, and then in the chapter 4, in the section 50, so there are a lot of about the duty of the Thai people to take care of the environment and water. And what I have seen is something like a joking. What I have seen, the constitution, it is approved, it is there. But what I have seen still there, the law, it does not fit with the constitution. And when I talk in the parliament, some of the members of the parliament keep joking. We never seen that the law is resolved. But what we have seen that the constitution is resolved from time to time. So the law is more important than the constitution in Thailand. So we don't rely on the principle. That is the reason why we cannot come up with a good conclusion to make our water plan. Duties, water resource belong to the public and state. It will belong to the public. They will have right to do this after they take care of the development, protect the water quality, allocate and usage and storage. And also, sorry that this is translation. Perhaps something is misunderstood. Right, the people have right. They have to do that duty to gain the right. Not the same as in the past. We state right first and then duty after. In decentralized society, we need to talk about duty. When you do your own duty, then you have right. The duty is we are talking about the function of the public sector and also the government agency, and then at the court we are talking about you have the mandate or not, you have the right or not, and then the recovery of the justice when something is mistaken and lost, then how the government can renovate them. And this is all the acts, more than 36 acts. As I say that the acts is more important than the constitution in Thailand, because a constitution can be resolved, but no one resolved the acts. And more than 2,000 royal decree, secondary law. This is the main obstacle, not the technical part. And you see that we grouping that some of the laws, some of the acts about the distribution, water resource, land and town planning, about 9, forestry, 4, remaining 3, or something like this. The law that able to create justice must be simple and general. How to simplify all this one? We don't need to state the new law. We need to how to integrate all this one, to link all this one, to work together. 36 acts, 2000 law. Secondary law, loyal act, loyal decree, and even a ministerial regulation. This is mentioned in the TDRI meeting, annual meeting, about the law in Thailand that we do have over 200,000, is it right, Professor? Yes. So we try to think in the other way, lead by political side, lead by management, and follow by right or law. We need to lead by duty and management and follow by law, not lead by right and follow by management, that what happened in the past. And then we are thinking about bottom up and top down, the way that we should think. Water management during the crisis situation systematical based and area based management system. Till now, we could not reach to this point. Or the agency, when they ask for the budget, they never submit the program base or the area base. They submit the project base. No relation among all the projects around them. The National Water Resource Policy that you have, all have duty and right. And then we do have that. I myself do think that we should reach to the point that good governance and sustainability. If we could not create a law that link top down and bottom up to work together. Right and duty, the government concept of the water resource management law should support to have a national water resource policy. It's about the same as the Netherlands, that we need to have an environment planning or policy to support this. The same as the national economic and social development plan should be at the same level. The law should support this one. And then structure the organization and the relation among the agency, the Thai agency, and establishment of the duty-based organization, not the right-based organization. When you are talking about the right base, then they are talking about who is right, who is wrong. They think about the fee, water fee or the other, and strong and sustainable community. This should support the local administration. And also the world, Dr. Anand, Professor Anand mentioned about the basin management and water resource management during the crisis situation and monetary mechanism. Because every year we have a budget for Loyal Irrigation Department over 30 billion. For the Department of Water Resource, about 20 billion baht. But for the local administration, it's over 50 billion baht. But how they spend that? No one support their technical part. So they spend 80% of the 50 billion baht for crisis management, and only 20% for development and conserve, because they don't have a good plan. But it's not their wrong. No one support them to have information to develop a good plan like the Netherlands has, adaptive planning. So important action required, the same as what you mentioned, evaluation and monitoring is a key point. This is to guarantee the continuity of the policy. If you have a good evaluation and monitoring system, then the continuity will come. So the duty, right, authority. This is the three main issue and the water resource. Then we are thinking about the structure and also the function. Upstream area, secondary. One thing that I should repeat again. In Thailand, only 20% is under irrigated area. 80% is in rain-fed. And in the north, only 13% is in irrigated area. And 87% is in rain-fed area. So this is the constraint or the context of our development. And then I do hope that with this one, we could have a water resource plan and policy for the normal situation. If we can improve the normal operation, then we can minimize the crisis. If we cannot improve the normal situation, then the crisis will come. The same as the new data that is filed by UNISDR. If you know about 7 days before crisis will happen, then the loss will be minimized. The loss will be minimized by almost 95%. And if you know 3 days before it happened, the loss will be minimized by 80%. But if you know only 1 day before, then the loss comes. This is, and then the upstream area, this is based on the area base. The upstream area, the water resource and development is a key point. And then at the primary and secondary irrigation system, I mean the big dam and a small dam. The largest dam that we have, 36 dams altogether, is 70 billion cubic meter, the capacity of that. But the annual average inflow is getting less and less. Right now it's almost 40,000 million cubic meter. So how could we recover all this situation? But when you look at a small pond or a small reservoir that is handled by the local administration, the capacity is less than 1 million cubic meter, but the inflow is sometimes 2 million. They can manage double of their own capacity. But the big reservoir can manage only 50% of their capacity. That is the weak point. Service for water supply and consumption and industry, you will see that with a salinity problem in the central part of Thailand, we have a more severe problem. And disaster and prevention and mitigation that would be done by the army, the service in America, or by the interior ministry. So I try to structure and propose that to this meeting. So the structure should be divided into 13 parts. One is about the duty and right. The second one is about the water resource management organization, the committee itself, the committee and the agency itself, and the structure of Dr. Anak mentioned a lot about the expert team. Yes, we need to have an expert committee. And also the water resource policy is the duty of this committee to state and review all this. And also water resource management in irrigated area, and also the conservation, and also the water resource management in rain-fed area that it would be done by the local administration, and groundwater management, how to link with that. Allocation and water services like a public authority, like a water authority, and also the water resource management during the crisis is a single command, and 10 evaluation and monitoring That is the key point. Water resource fund, penalties, and transitory provision. Thank you.
I try to follow the internal protocol by Dr. Nebel, but maybe we should have maybe four or five slides, or maybe no slides at all. So I try to follow. It seems that only me that has no slides. But yeah, I will talk about water governance reform, but focusing mainly on the implementation part, the small part of the whole water law. I agree with water law is very important as a tool, also as a policy and also as a tool. Viewing it from public administration, the public sector, public agency needs some tool to do something. And when I observe the implementation of the current legal framework that is called Office of Prime Minister Regulation on National Resource, Water Resource Management. It lacked a lot of quality. Actually, illegal term it is subordinate registration with no background or primary registration, so it's no power. And to bring it in a way, it cannot even be enforced on the individual or non-private or non-public sector because it needs to be a reform. Center. So water law is very important in a way. Another thing is that water law is it takes very long. I think it has been tried for nearly 30 years. The first one is in 1992, and then it wouldn't even pass through the parliament. And then it come again around 2000, initiated by ADB and then follow up and so on and so forth. And then it didn't work out. Even with the military regime in 2007, it came very close. It came to the second reading, but it didn't go to the final reading. And this time, the first draft was submitted to the cabinet in January 2015. It eventually landed at the National Legislative Assembly in March this year. So to be precise, it took already 2 years and 2 months to get in the first meetings. And Dr. Royal also a member of the committee select to consider the draft. And last week, I think it's only come to the Article 54. For 3 months past already. So it didn't even make to the second meeting. So you never know whether it will eventually come for the second meeting because we have something like 100 articles on this draft. You know? When everything is going on, and then it might come. come for the second reading and third reading, and hopefully it passed. If it passed in those, I think it is going to be really a big step for, you know, water government reform in Thailand as a tool for public sector involvement to implement. Having said that, it doesn't mean that water law is a silver bullet for everything, but it provides a really nice tool for public sector or public bodies involved. But again, as the speaker mentioned about implementation, then come the water government reform on the ground. How what described in the law implemented on the ground, right? So I focus on the River Basin Committee. When I look at the law, it's maybe a deja vu for me because it resembles exactly the minister, Prime Minister Office regulation on river basin management. You have now I have slides for that. So you see here is the for the what is described in the draft for one river basin committee, right? You have provincial governor as an ex officio, he will be or she will be a member anyway, and then director of our Department of Water Resources Regional Office as a member and secretary. And then representative from department, 10 departments. And then representative from local government organization, one province each. Right? And then representative from water user organization, so 9 members. In this category, they're divided into 3 parts, from agriculture, from industry, from commerce, so 3 ESO, and 9 members. And then expert, local expert, 3 members. With Department of River of Water Resources as a secretariat. So if we implemented, given being river basin as a example, we end up with 33 members, right? So actually, with the white one, you see, probably we would like to focus on that. Then we have only 9 members. And if we look closely, there are only 3 from agriculture, right? If we want to help some farmers, so only 3 members. So, and it is stated in the bill that for the decision making, it has to be a simple majority vote. So you can see who will end up winning and losing if it actually comes to the board for something, right, in the river basin. And this is one issue that I think water government or the governance reform might not be that smooth when implemented on the ground. Farmers will not have much voice on this committee. And then there are also some issues that I would like to focus on in my talk. It is how the River Basin Committee manage itself, how it is administrated, right? So when I look at the Pink River Basin Committee now, that is currently exists, there is no, I would call it, no really governing form of it. For example, the first one, the meeting. How is often the meeting of the committee? If it's supposed to solve some problem like drought or flood, right? Or solve the conflict of water users. Right now, we have 2 meetings. You can see one at the beginning of the fiscal year, the other one at the end of the fiscal year. So one year you have 2 meetings. So it's really, really difficult, right? This is one thing. And then who is the one to call for the meeting? This is the chairman of the committee. Right now it's not, it is the secretary. So he will go for when and where. And having said that, where to meet, what is the venue for being liver basin here in Chiang Mai, right in the north. It has already been in Chiang Mai because the Chiang Mai is based here in Chiang Mai. So imagine people travel 200, 300 kilometers to attend a meeting, right? There is no rotation like this. So look at the view. It doesn't describe, as Dr. Moni said, who does what or what is the investigation what the public agency involved should do, right? So, and also, what else that is concerned? Also, the when I look at the articles of the bill, the Liver Basin Committee have several mandates, right? To prepare a water resource master plan for the river basin. The problem is that there is no article in the bill to mention who is going to be implemented, who is going to be follow this water resource master plan. So if it is like this, the River Basin Committee can issue several master plans. But it will be there. It's just a plan, it's no implementation. Because there is no enforcing or no provision in the law to specify who will be implementing that water resource management plan. Like Dr. Loyun mentioned, there are 80% of the country in rainfed, and mostly fall in the hand of local government organizations. And they can implement whatever they like, of course in a good way somehow. But with no direction, with no perspective of real within or in the local perspective. This master plan can provide that, but there is no provision to buy them to follow this master plan. So it will end up as a document as okay. Right? This is also my concern. And what else? Yeah, and it seems like it's only focused in the bill for Liver Basin Committee is to issue the water permit for category 2, which means used for commercial agricultural industry. If so, then this committee is just a stamp for the work permit and then representative for water user organization, we have no say, because that's the same. When you come to a vote of decision making, it will be outnumbered anyway, right? And also the structure of the Thai public administration also put constraint into the implementation of the River Basin Committee. For example, the director of Department of Water Resources Regional Office has to be secretary, right? So for office number one, he oversee, or she will oversee, already four River Basin Committee. Only if he could clone himself, then he can be at the meeting, if need be, for the four. And also some other representative as well, like Department of Ground Water Resources. He or she also oversee the whole northern part, which cover also four river basins as well. So the structure of Thai administration also put constraint on to implement the reform on the ground as well. And this only focus on the small part, as is a river basin. I think this is going to be a challenge, and I hope that the committee select, Dr. Royon, you try to put some prescription on the subordinate legislation, like Ministry of Regulation or Royal Decree, how to direct the implementation. I give one example of the Royal Decree on provincial administration and provincial cluster administration. I don't know how they would trick but it's really precise. It's really precise and detail every direction. For example, a provincial is recognized as a public entity under the budget law, which means province can propose a plan for budget allocation. There is no in the water bill. Only say that Department of Water Resources should prepare budget for National Water Resource Committee and River Basin Committee will be insufficient in data. Right? And it also provides a prescribe in this royal decree for provincial cluster that if budget proposal submitted, the budget bureau has to accommodate that proposal. So as I said, I don't know how they do the trick, but it's really prescribed in that, which means every province can submit the proposal and then they get budget allocation by the budget bureau to provide and request budget. But for our water resource management or water resource committee, there is no just a prescription. I hope Dr. Royan can narrate somehow in that direction, right? And for this, I would just like to show how the complexity of the Thai administration, right? We have three separate administration level, central one in Bangkok, and then we have provincial administration like in province, and we have 76 provinces, and we have local administration which increasingly become autonomous. And if you think about these member, so we pull all the three together, so it's going to be very difficult to go beyond all law and regulation. As Dr. Royan mentioned, we have 26 water act and we have 200 subordinate registration. We dictate everything. You want to go somewhere, you have to ask for permission. So if the water, the river basin committee from, let's say, Nakhon Sawan is part of the river, would like to come to attend the meeting in Chiang Mai, with immediate, no, it has to ask for permission, not of the world. So this is also one thing I would like to focus on for just one part of implementation of water law with concerning River Basin Committee. I think it's going to be a very challenge to overcome our barrier on both first, the structural barrier of the Thai administration itself, like this, and also how to exercise some of the mandate without not with a clear prescription of what to do or what they can do. As I mentioned again, I really like this article in that royal decree. It's really comprehensive. I don't know how they pull the trick, because you see in that royal decree on provincial administration, they prescribe, they recognize the province, they will provide a forum or channel to get the budget, and it also binds the budget bureau to provide the budget requested, so it's really comprehensive. So that one province is really strong. Okay, this is our talk, but there are also some, you see here is the meeting of the Metang irrigation project with the canal. And the meeting is really lively, very, you know, face-to-face and lot of discussion. They seem relaxed, but the matter is really serious because of the water, and then they get no water, and then they try to negotiate, right? But when compared to meeting of the River Basin Committee, it's really formalized and you got to sit and then listen and then no discussion. But for the Meta Anglication, it took years. It started after 1995 to talk, and then finally they could come to the table like this, molecular, maybe 2009 or something. So I think what challenge may be, what a lot is needed, because it provides the authority and provide tools. Maybe we have to refine, maybe we have to put some direction on the what should be done and what, who, like Dr. Moyer said, who should ask what, right, in the direction at the beginning, when we can try to fine tune and add up our device along the way. But we really need to sort of water law.
One reason we never have a national water law is power game between the Department of Water Resource and the Department of Irrigation to stay friendly. Now, what Dr. Suki is mentioning, there will be another ministry coming into the power game. The Ministry of Interior, which is even much more powerful than the Ministry of Agriculture and Ministry of Environment. Watch out.
Like I mentioned, because the provincial administration really clear and very convincing was pushed by Ministry of Interior so that they can come up with a very precise and
that's why the law will never be passed in Thailand, as long as the power structure remains. Okay, the next speaker, the last one.